Thank you, Juliana. Well, welcome all. Our first paper is by Federico Costantini. Prego la regia di passare il computer. Grazie. And I believe that I should start talking from here now. Well, this is basically our most contemporary paper, I guess. Federico Costantini is both a lawyer and a research fellow at the University of Udine. And he's gonna give us this very interesting work on how in the digital age, what's smuggling in the digital age. So please, Federico,
you thank you. Have 20 minutes. Thank you very much for inviting me here, and thank you, Bojan, and thank you, Juliana. I would like to speak of a different kind of smuggling, which is a kind of digital smuggling, but also I would like to try to reach the core meaning of smuggling, just as Sabina said before. So this is the index, the summary of my speech, which will deal with a case. If smuggling anthologies are a lot of cases, I show my case, which is the case of the Pretty Good Privacy, and then I will try to make a context of this case, and then I will try to take some conclusions of this story, of the story I tell. In the first part, I will do four things, which is describe the premises of the case, narrate the facts of the case, describe the aftermath, and try to understand what was going after, and because I'm a lawyer, I will try to point out what is the legal problem of this kind of smuggling. The premises are well known. In the Cold War, there were a lot of secrets, and during the Second World War, governments started to understand that cryptography was a key for the success of the wars. So, during the Cold War, the government of the United States of America divided two kind of goods for the export. One were munitions, like guns or bullets, and the other was dual-use technology, which was something that you can use in war, but also not. Let's say food delivery for army. This is a dual-use thing. Food is a kind of dual-use technology. And in 1976, the fact is that there was invented a particularly strong way to decrypt things, messages. So the American government issued a law that considered encryption as a weapon. So, if you can see here, it's very clear that export of cryptography was a kind of contraband of war. And this is very strong as a punishment. If you see, there are a lot of years to pass in jail if you export cryptography. So this is the situation. This man, which is called Philip Zimmermann, was a computer programmer and a civil activist. And when the Senate of USA issued this bill to control citizens' communication, he went out of his job. He stayed 6 months home without any kind of revenue, and risking of being eradicated from this house. and risking to be that we could be evicted by his house, and he started to think how to encrypt messages. And after 6 months, he invented this program, which is called Pretty Good Privacy. For this thing, when he started to spread his invention to friends, the friends were going on public telephones and uploaded it on the BBS, which was a kind of social network of 20 years ago. And the program started to spread all over the country. And for this, the US government arrested Zimmerman and started a legal case. But the smuggling, the real smuggling, the real export, the issue, the legal issue, was this book. Because geniusly, Zimmerman smuggled something which was considered secret, like encryption, publishing it in a book. He wrote the whole program in this book, and the book was sold all over the world. If you want, you could also buy it on the Amazon, if you want. John Perley Barlow, which was a kind of visionary, which was a lyricist of the Grateful Dead, which wrote the Declaration of Independence of the Internet, said this thing on the premise of this book, and said that the genie of the guerrilla cryptography is out of the bottle, and the borders are laughably cold so by America, because there is no limit to the spread of information. But at the same time, it is a problem. It is a problem of conscience. But after all this, arose some issues, three issues more or less. The first is, how could you persecute a citizen for exercising a freedom, if you are the US government and you believe in freedom? How prosecute one man while all the others use the same program? And the third issue is, how prosecute a citizen, an inventor, which has invented something that is become a standard, a technological standard used all over the world and by all institutions like banks, organizations, governments, and citizens and companies. After all these considerations, the government dropped the case and archived the charges. If you see this press statement, you see that the government said you have to better check with the State Department. You have to control what you are doing. But if you read a law, you cannot find this kind of expression. It's a kind of warning, it's a mobster warning, more than lawyer's speech or legislator's speech. This is the aftermath. As you can see, Zimmerman became an hero for the pro-computer programming community in the world. He was inducted in the Hall of Fame, and then the PGP, Pretty Good Privacy, spread all over the world and became a standard in computer security. But you should better check what you're doing. In fact, if you, as you can see here, the US government, as the European community, and here I inserted the laws of European Union, which are related with encryption, issued that and agreed with this kind of international agreement on the dual use technologies. So encryption is still limited as a traded good. Now, the legal issues. The most important legal issue I want to speak about is this, is the First Amendment and is the freedom of expression, because it is the key which allowed Zimmerman to export cryptography. Zimmermann said, when he uploaded the program, I'm not exporting anything because I'm doing here it on national soil. Yes, said the American government, but internet is worldwide, so anyone in the world could download it. The next thing that the next argument that Zimmermann was dealing was found grounding his conduct is I'm not doing anything wrong because I'm doing something that is in public domain. I'm publishing a book. Yes, said the American government, but can you consider a software a kind of freedom of expression? It's not a poem, it's not a novel, it's an algorithm. The objection of Zimmermann, and is there is a lot of there are a lot of cases in American jurisprudence of this. It is that it is not necessary to speak. When you exercise freedom of expression, you can also act like, for example, burning a flag. So this is the argument concerning legal freedom. I will pass the others that you will find on the paper. And I imagine the question that you can ask in this moment. What is the meaning of this case now, after 20 years? Here, we are not in in America. My answer is this. It is that maybe there is the reason why this case can be considered as smuggling in a smuggling ontology. And the reason is in the second part of this speech, and is relating with the meaning of the frontier, the meaning of smuggling, the meaning of the punishment of smuggling. And I divided this meaning in three times, three phases, ancient times, modern times, and information age. And as you can see, every phase has a key concept. Ancient times have a natural order, and modernity is the rational system, the legal system, and information is the key concept, is a control of information. As you can see here from the picture, this is Prometheus. Prometheus was a smuggler. He smuggled the fire from the gods to the humans. Why? What is the meaning of the frontier in the ancient times? For me, the meaning is a kind of passage. It's a continuity between our world and the realm of spirituality, what is outside of this life and of this experience. The smuggling is breaking this order and doing evil. It is not good to trade illicit goods. The punishment is simply a castigation of an impious. In modern age, and this is Al Capone, a great smuggler of the Prohibition, the image comes from a t-shirt that you can buy on internet also. The frontier is simply a physical limit on the sovereign power. This is my limit. I am the sovereign here, not outside. Outside, you are the sovereign. Here, I am the king. Smuggling is simply a disenchantment against the legal system. I don't believe in this legal system, so I can smuggle. I don't believe in your law. The punishment in the modern age is means to prevent others to smuggle. This is the issue. And what in the modern age? In the modern age, we don't have frontiers. We have just domains of available resources. As you can see here, there is no physical world. There are circles. Smuggling is simply concealing information from the others. The punishment is exclusion from shared information. What can you do to kill someone? You cut the line. You exclude him from shared information. So, also in ancient times and in modernity, what is smuggling basically? Basically, for me, it can be seen as a kind of deception. The smuggler creates an information asymmetry with the custom officer. He hides something, he sneaks through paths nighttime, or he forges documents or corrupts the custom officer. This is a physical thing. You need a frontier, you need a border. But in the information age, you don't have borders, you have encryption. So encryption is in itself a kind of smuggling. You encode or decode as you can hide or create appearance. Here I put a kind of scheme of what I'm saying. So you can say that in the plain text you can have something that is visible, and in the ciphertext you can see something that is hidden. And the process is circular. So there is a question. What is the problem? I can encrypt everything if I want. I am free to oppose the power. I am free to oppose the control of information. I am free to go against the system. Yes, also Zimmermann thought in this way, and in fact he was a civil activist. But there are some things that are not quite fitting. This is the first. This is the first metal gun entirely 3D printed. You don't need anymore to smuggle arms or through physical frontiers. You can download a file, you can have a 3D printer metal in this case, and then you can create your own reason. The title, the name of the gun is quite amazing for me. The reason of the power, the reason of the fact, I have the reason. This is another thing. Thanks to Zimmermann, you can buy everything on internet. This is Silk Road, that is a marketplace where you can buy killers, drugs, everything you want. It's free, it's encrypted. All thanks to Zimmermann again. So the problem is that in the information age, you cannot have this contrast between freedom and control, because everything goes with control of information, which is an absolute power. You have available resources or not. So, what is the question of information age? And here I'm going to the conclusion of my speech. There are no physical barriers, there are no physical boundaries anymore, but there are something called cyber boundaries. Again, the gate, information goes through the gate or not, simply. Internet in itself has been weaponized, has become a weapon. So there is no more difference between contraband of war, smuggling, or simple communication or freedom of expression. Everything that a state cannot control is simply a threat. Here I inserted this Tallinn manual, that is a manual is a study of the NATO, I think it's the name, okay, and which says that a hacker that can put in danger to vital systems of a state, let's say electric system or gas system or anything, or a hospital and so on, can be killed as a terrorist. There is no more difference between a simple criminal and a terrorist. So, basically, what the smuggler does is simply the same thing that the custom officer does, which is control of information. Everyone bows, in this sense, to the power of information. You can say, yes, interesting, but smuggling today, what can it be? What could it be smuggling in the information age? And here I have maybe an answer. I know my speech was kind of catastrophic or apocalyptic, but I think that maybe there could be a solution or a change of perspective that is in this. This is one of the most important philosophers of law, which is Ugo Grozio, Ugo van der Groot. And he was sentenced to death during a war of religions between Armenians and Gomarists in the Netherlands in the 17th century. And he escaped from the prison, hiding himself in a cave or in a trunk of books. I think this is a good use of culture. And here I thank you very much for being patient.